In the philosophy series, we discussed two major philosophies of the Hindus, Sankhya and Yoga. Now we check up the next three in the series, Nyay, Vaisheshik and Mimamsa. First, Nyay. It said that there was a great sage, Gautam. He founded the system of Nyay, which is also known as Logical Realism. We don't really know the antecedents of Gautam, where exactly he was born, where he lived. We do come across one Gautam in Valmiki's Ramayana. His wife was Ahalya, and there's some story about Ahalya and Indra and then Sri Rama. It may be that Gautam or it may be some other Gautam. So, personalities never matter in Hindu philosophy. It's the thoughts. Thoughts really play the crucial, the important role in Hindu system. Whether it be philosophy or it be some kind of creation, be it spiritual thoughts, in none of these any personality is involved. It is the principles. It is the impersonal nature of the principles that's important. Since the principles are important, that's why no personality or no person ever gets the credit. It is only in the recent times that we find everybody trying to shout and scream to take credit for all the silly things that they do. We don't find any creativity anywhere around, and yet we find people trying to show off as if they are being hugely creative. Nyaya, if you go by the word Sanskrit, it means that which is right. It's a very common Indian word. It's used practically in every language in India. Nyaya, justice. But technically it means that which is right. And this system of thought concerns with correct way of thinking. Your thought process must be cleansed. You must be able to see things correctly in proper perspective. And that's why its name, it is also known as logical realism. It depends on, it's a realistic system of thought, and it lays a lot of emphasis on logic. That's why logical realism. And Nyay believes that the true knowledge of reality, that is God or Atman, and the ultimate goal, Mukti, can be achieved only through right way of knowledge. And as in every other Indian system of thought, every Indian philosophy, the goal of Nyaya, although it is logic, goal is liberation. Mukti, liberation of the individual soul. But in this, the thrust, the real thrust lies on clear thinking, born of proper reasoning. And you will be surprised to know that the arguments used by the Nyaya philosophers, they're so subtle that in India they are considered to be the finest brains. Nyaya requires the finest minds, and over thousands of years their reasonings have been chiseled. They're chiseled so fine that it's practically impossible to argue with them. And Nyaya later on became extremely popular amongst the learned, and when it reached Mithila, the Navya Nyaya came up, the neo logical realism, and later it moved over to Bengal, and Nadia Navadvip area became very famous for Navya Nyaya. Navya Nyaya is another system of thought, but it belongs to Nyaya. So Navya Nyaya is often tagged with Nyaya. But then the arguments used in Navya Nyaya are much more fine. In fact, I must admit, let's see, I'm not really a student of philosophy. I don't understand much of philosophy. And it's practically impossible for me to understand the arguments used in Nyaya. They are so subtle, so fine. It's only the broad things that I can make out. But then there are very good books through which you can know what exactly Nyaya stands for. And just you can imagine this way, that the kind of arguments that Nyaya uses for everything, it is comparable directly with the best arguments, best logic used in the world, in the Western world. And it's, you know, there are scholars, Western scholars, who want to study Nyaya, because the study of a sentence, the study of a statement, it goes so deep in it to find the correct meaning and to be absolutely reasonable, to be just, to be reasonable. It's so fine that scholars find it amazing. Naturally, Nyaya was not made for common man, because a common man cannot understand the subtleties of Nyaya. But its method of reasoning, it was so strong that in spite of all kinds of schools of thoughts in India being there, they could not uproot the Nyaya philosophy. Those who have studied Nyaya, those who belong to the school of Nyaya, they say that they like to hear Vedanta, they love the arguments of Vedanta, but they don't agree with them. Because to them, the arguments used by Vedanta, they sound beautiful. But when it comes to logic, pure reasoning, Nyaya people consider Vedanta to be far inferior, which in fact is not true. But then we are too ordinary to discuss all that. Now, Shankaracharya, later on Shankaracharya, who consolidated Vedanta philosophy, used this argument system of Nyaya to build Vedanta. And of course, Shankaracharya demolished Nyaya. When it comes to arguments, if you chance to read those books where Shankaracharya argues with Nyaya philosophy, he just demolishes them. But of course, Nyayik, people who follow Nyaya are known as Nyayik. They don't accept those things, and Nyaya school of thought thrives, but then it thrives only with some really refined minds, great scholars. Look, we will not be getting into the logical aspect of Nyaya, which is really huge. And it's really meant only for the great minds. We will confine ourselves only to the theological aspects. The aspect that concerns directly with religion, with Hinduism. Now, Nyaya accepts, there are just very few simple points, that Nyaya accepts the soul as a unique substance. Now, the interesting term is substance, drabhya. The term is substance. Now, this is where things go wrong between Nyaya and Vedanta. It considers it as a substance. And what substance actually means, we shall study in the next philosophy, Vaisheshika. Now, being a substance, it has feelings. It feels pain, desires, pleasure, etc. And there are different selves in different bodies. That means, myself is different from yourself. And that's why when one person is liberated, the other person does not get liberated. And the self itself, Atman, the self, it is indestructible, eternal, and infinite. Infinite because it is not limited in time and space, even though it's a substance. Now that's a very interesting argument. You might think that how is it possible? Infinite, as Vedanta accepts, and as Swamiji has explained, infinite is infinite. And you cannot have two infinities. Although we know that in mathematics, you can have many kinds of infinities. But in spirituality, when it comes to consciousness, infinity is infinity. You cannot have two infinities. Surprisingly, the definition of infinity in Nyaya is slightly different. When they talk of Atman as being infinite and yet many, so there is many infinities, they mean to say that it is not confined in time. That is, it's not born in time and it does not die with time. And its knowledge, etc. It's not only that it's not confined in time, it's not even confined in space, in the sense that it's free. You cannot confine it as such. That's why it is defined to be infinite. And the moment we think of Atman, those of you who have been listening to these talks and those who have some idea about Vedanta, the first thing that we know of Atman is that it is self-conscious. Nyaya does not accept that Atman is self-conscious. Self itself, the soul, is not self-conscious according to Nyaya. But the moment it comes in contact with the mind and in contact with senses, it becomes conscious. Now, I'm giving you a very simplistic presentation of Nyaya philosophy. If you really study it with a proper master, you will agree with everything that Nyaya says. And then you will believe that everything Nyaya says is correct and whatever Vedanta says is not correct. It's something like, you know, we can just have a crude example. There is electricity. Electricity is there, but it cannot be felt. The moment it passes through this set tube light, the light appears, then you know that there is electricity. It's something like that. Atman is there. But since it is not identified with anything, supposing there is you think of a chamber and you throw light in it and it's a glass chamber. You will never know if light is there or not. To know that light is there, there has to be some particle that the light will illuminate. In the space, when the sunlight comes, you cannot know whether sunlight is there or not till you put an object. It's something similar to that. The moment this self gets identified with mind and senses, consciousness arises. And when the consciousness arises, it starts experiencing pleasure, pain, etc. And to be liberated means to get disjointed from the mind. Once it gets disjointed from the mind, it's liberated. So, if you apply the common sense, the approach of Vedanta is something similar to that. We, when I talk of I-ness, my I-ness is identified with my mind. The moment there is that disassociation from the mind, the soul is free. So, Nyaya philosophy also accepts the same. But the other definition and description of the soul is entirely different from what Vedanta has to say. Now, this disassociation of the soul with the mind does not come that easily. For that, one has to study the Vedas. We had mentioned that Hindu philosophy is strictly based on the Vedas. And Nyaya believes that first you have to study the Vedas. You have to understand the import, what exactly those statements mean to say. And then you have to reason them out. You have to reason them out. For example, there is this famous Gayatri Mantra which we discussed earlier. First you have to study it, then you have to try to understand, and then you have to understand the meaning, reason it out thoroughly. Only then you can meditate on it. And once you meditate, and ultimately you reach that stage where yourself, your thinking becomes separate from the mind, and then it is liberation. Surprisingly, although it's logical realism and it has a wonderful reasoning system, it believes that all your spiritual efforts and everything depends on the grace of God. God's grace becomes very, very important in Nyaya. In Nyaya system, normally we say that be logical. Like once in a while, when we see on social media where people talk about faith and reasoning, sometimes I feel like telling people that you don't know that your ancestors, who have been the greatest minds and greatest rationalists, the logical realism, they will not accept a thing unless it's fully real, fully rational and fully logical. They believe that whatever happens, happens due to grace of God. And this, in fact, nothing in this world that happens without His grace. So, and how they define God? It says that God is eternal. It's infinite self that creates, maintains and destroys the universe. That means, if you think of yourself as a small self, God is that infinite self, the world soul. And the creation that is there, it does not come out of nothing, and it is carried out by the eternally existing atoms. We shall discuss that in the Vaisheshik. And these existing atoms are not the atoms that we know in physics, but these are the atoms of space, time, akash, ether, mind and souls. There are existing atoms, and then there are space, time, ether, mind and soul. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 plus 1, 6. These are known as 6 drabhya, 6 substances. So there is that soul, there is mind, there is ether, akash, there is time, there is space, kal. There is kal, there is disha, and akash. These are the technical terms, and with that there are atoms. These atoms are eternally existent, and they are coexistent with God. And when God wants creation, He puts them in order. God is also the moral governor of the universe, who, like a loving father, directs all souls to do good and bad and gives fruits of those acts. Now that creates a very interesting situation. Like you might have heard of, it's God's will. God guides you to do good. God guides you to do bad. Nyay believes in that. And it believes that the creation continues only because it goes on like this. And acts of soul in any of the spheres of existence are strictly according to the will of God, who keeps them either under bondage or liberates it. And Nyay gives 10 proofs of the existence of God and will of God. They are very famous, known as 10 proofs. There are 10 proofs. For example, one of the very interesting thing is that whenever there is creation, you know that there is a creator. The moment you say, see, there is a pen, this is a creation. So it automatically involves that there is a creator. And then from there, they will go to discuss in the finest and minutest detail that why it has to be so, why it cannot be a blind chance. And see, the kind of arguments used by Nyay philosophies in discussing these 10 proofs of God, they are so exhaustive, so intricate, so subtle, that they cover the entire philosophical arguments used in every other religion of the world. If you take, say, Christianity or Islam or Judaism, Buddhism, you just take every religion. Whatever great arguments and fine arguments they have to use have been already used by Nyay philosopher thousands of years ago. They're so fine, and it's not easy to contradict them. When we are discussing all this, you might feel that these are very naive. Yes, these things will sound very naive because we are not getting into the finer aspects of the arguments. It's not possible, not even needed. Like those who are interested can read in any of the philosophy books. They are so intricate. So that entire Western religious philosophy we are using, and remember that till say the last 100-150 years, the entire Western philosophy was religious philosophy. So every argument that they have to use for the existence of God have been used by Nyaya philosophy. And ultimately it is pluralistic realism. Pluralistic. That means the real are many, not only one. For example, remember, Sankhya has two reals, Purusha and Prakriti. As we mentioned, Purusha, there are only two real. In Vedanta, there is only one real. God alone exists. But in Nyaya, you have six reals, as we mentioned. So this is known as pluralistic realism. Those are real, those existences are real and plural, not one, not two, but more than two. To be very honest, the arguments and logic used by Nyaya, they are great, but its theology is not as great as its logic. And that's why they say, like, I grew up amongst the Nyayiks. My early childhood, I'm not talking about monastic days, before that, I grew up with the Nyayiks. And we knew the way they could argue and the way they could just go on cutting down each other's arguments. Intellectual wrangling, and it can lead you nowhere. And ultimately your ego is so bloated. Because it's human to be victorious. You like to be victorious. And when you defeat somebody in an argument, you feel good. And Nyayiks are master at that. They can defeat anybody. They'll just take the meaning of word, they will take word, and they will take the meaning of word, they will take your statement, and they will argue with you in such a way that you cannot stand before them. As happens in our courts, great legal minds, when they get up to argue, they can prove anything. They may even prove that you don't exist in front of him. I mean, you are not standing in front of him. That's the legal minds, that's what they do. Nyaya philosophers are something like that. That their arguments are great, but their theology is not as great. So many consider this as intellectual gymnastics, but Nyaya philosophers will not agree to that. But when it comes to the genuine, correct way of thinking, Nyaya is really great. And through pure reasoning, the contributions made by Nyaya in the fields of, say, life, existence, God, reality, they have thrown up such gems that they have permeated the Hindu system of thought very deeply. And later, Vedanta took up the system of thought, the system of reasoning by Nyaya, and came up with a complete system that made Vedanta what it is today. Although the scholars of Nyaya do not agree with those philosophies, but it's a fact that Vedanta ultimately overcame the limitations that were theological limitations, we would say, in Nyaya. And with Nyaya comes the philosophy of Vaisheshiks. Vaisheshiks are the atomists. We will discuss Vaisheshiks.